Members, it's the appointed time. We have a quorum. I call the meeting to order. Let's first invite the government and the representatives from the Insurance Authority to join us. We now invite officials to have a seat. On the 10th of May, the House Committee agreed to set up this subcommittee. We are dealing with 14 pieces of subsidiary legislation related to Cap 41, the insurance ordinance. This has to do with the risk-based capital regime and intermediaries' fees. Now, based on some prior communications, members' concerns have to do with the license fees for intermediaries and related fees. This means the content of the subsidiary legislation related to the fees and the other pieces of subsidiary legislations have to do with the details of the RBC regime. Now, based on the Insurance Amendment Ordinance 2023, and also a meeting of the panel on financial affairs, where we also had a discussion about the subsidiary legislation. We are dealing with a legal framework based on the ordinance and also many rounds of consultations of the insurance sector. The insurance industry has no objection. The RBC regime's technical details are not the concerns of this subcommittee. So I invite the government to give us a highlight so we don't have to delve into the details of the lengthy subsidiary legislation. Members are welcome to offer comments or raise questions about the policy aspects, and we will also invite the government and the IA to give a response. And then we will then focus on the insurance prescribed fees amendment regulation 2024, and then we can have a focused discussion about the license fees and other fees for insurance intermediaries so that we can go ahead in an efficient manner. So members, are we all agreed on this approach? If members are all agreed, so I will first invite Ms. Estrella Cheung from the government to deliver the opening remarks. Thank you, Chairman. We're dealing with 14 pieces of subsidiary legislation covering two areas. One, the risk-based capital regime. Last July, LegCo passed the Insurance Amendment Ordinance 2023. That was passed to create a framework for the RBC regime. This is also meant to strengthen the resilience of insurers and also align ourselves with international practice. Now, once that bill was passed, the IA was empowered to come up with the detailed regulations. The IA has compiled the regulations and then consulted the insurance industry. So we will see six pieces of subsidiary legislation containing those new rules. Those rules have to do with capital valuation and reporting. We're also repealing three obsolete rules. To implement the new regime, amendments are also needed to some regulations made by the Chief Executive in Council. Those have to do with actuaries and fees. So that's for the amendments dealing with the RBC regime. Now, there's another aspect, and that is the intermediaries fees. Back in September 2019, the IA started monitoring, supervising the intermediaries, but there was a consensus. We wanted to have a five-year transitional period, 5 years of waiver for intermediaries, and that period will expire in September this year. This means, after lengthy discussions between the IA and the insurance sector, there will be fees that covers individual insurance agents, insurance companies, brokerages. And that covers new licensees, renewal of licensees, and also adding a new line of business to existing licensees. In compiling these standards, the principle is cost recovery. Now, we have also looked at the fees of other bodies. Industry consultations were done, the fees were lowered, flexibility has been built in. We believe the current level of fees has the acceptance of the insurance industry. So that's all from me for the 14 pieces of subsidiary legislation. I will now invite members to raise questions about the policy aspects. Members who wish to speak, please press the request to speak button now. First, Mr. Kwok Wai Kong, 5 minutes for you. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you for consulting us and coordinating the work so that we can have a focused discussion about the subsidiary legislation we have in mind. The IA is there to regulate the industry. The insurance industry is also a key industry of the local scene. Now, I want to focus on the IA's financial position. To set up the IA, we spent $950 million of public money to create the IA. Each year, the IA has been in the red. So once we have these fees with the subsidiary legislation, what will the financial position of the IA be like? Will the IA be able to break even? And if we cannot balance the books with the IA, then I have a concern. In 2024 to 2025, the expenditure is expected to be $627 million, but the revenue is expected to be somewhere about $500 million only. So again, the IA will be in the red. I've seen reports about the IA, about hiring more people, and also procuring different professional services. So are there control measures in place to spend within the means on the IA side in terms of manpower and expenditure? The IA should have plans in place instead of letting the deficit continue. I want to focus on the insurance prescribed fees amendment regulation 2024 for a reason, because this has to do with the intermediaries' fees. These fees are going way up from the pre-COVID years. Back then, it was $400 for 3 years, but now we started $1,900 for 3 years. The fees were waived for 5 years, but now you're taking all that money back in one go. That's how the industry sees it. So is it because of the fiscal position of the IA that you are bumping up the fees like that? I would like a response on this. I will stop at these three questions for now. Thank you. Ms. Estrella Cheng. Now, I want to first comment on the financial position of the IA. Indeed, when you look at the IA and you compare that with other regulators, IA is not exactly in a great spot. The IA has only been set up for a few years. Let's look at last year. IA managed to balance the books last year, but that wasn't about the budget. That simply was the result of more manpower losses. The higher wastage led to lower expenditure, and that balanced the books. To balance the books in long term, that's also the goal of the IA. So the IA would like to get the fees that are supposed to be payable to the IA. For intermediaries' fees, the principle is cost recovery. That's why pre-COVID it was $400 or so, and now it's $1,900. When a broker or an agent provides or works on a certain line of business for 3 years, they pay that fee. But if they only work on a certain line of business, say life insurance, for 3 years it's only $810 instead of $1,900. So if someone renews their current license, just over one third will pay the $1,900. Just over one third will keep paying the $800 fee. So I want to stress that not everyone will see a jump from $400 to $1,900. So cost recovery really depends on the licenses involved and the manpower involved. Pre-COVID, it was self-regulation in the industry. There's a difference in the scope, and that also explains the difference in the cost. Mr. Kwok also mentioned control over expenditure. Members may recall that back in March this year, the IA and I joined legislature at a meeting. We discussed the IA's budget. Every year, the IA's budget requires the approval from the financial secretary. And before we submitted our budget to the financial secretary, we would come to legislature for a detailed discussion. So in terms of cost control, we do have rigorous control. Now, the IA has yet to balance its books. It has to watch its spending carefully, and we will stick to this principle. I will stop here. Thank you. Mr. Kwok has answered all your questions. I will raise follow-up questions later. Mr. Robert Lee, thank you. So we're dealing with the risk-based capital regime and insurance intermediary fees. We have maintained good engagement with the FSTB. We had a discussion at the panel on financial affairs. I'm grateful to the authorities for the communication. We're talking about a new regime. So how do we strike a balance between development and regulation? And we also need to minimize the negative impact on the industry. From what I know, many insurers can meet the new requirements, but there are a small number of insurers who cannot meet the new rules. So how can we show our businesses that we have a great business environment in Hong Kong? How can we show people that our environment is not unduly onerous? Now, we support this RBC regime. We believe this regime can enhance the financial soundness of insurers. The government also told us they looked at international standards and the practices across different jurisdictions. Now, on intermediary fees, we waived that fee for 5 years from 2019. Now we are charging that fee again. How do we minimize the impact of such fees? Those fees represent a cost, after all. Now, there's a principle, and that is the cost recovery principle. Can the government tell us how you arrive at the cost? Now, for those being regulated, they are worried. When you keep adding workers to the IA and everyone is well paid, smaller insurers may struggle to keep up with those costs. I want to speak on behalf of small insurers. Smaller insurers create jobs, they pay taxes too, they contribute to the economy. So maybe the government can tell us more about those points. Deputy Secretary.
Thank you, Mr. Lee, for the questions. I think, first of all, I'll respond to the part on the LBC regime. Well, last year, when the amendment ordinance was passed from 2017 to 2019, we have conducted three rounds of quantitative impact assessments. And we have been liaising with each and every insurer, irrespective of their size. So during the process, we would hope that the IA would understand about the operation of the different insurers. Also, we hope that the individual insurers would understand about the new regulatory requirements. So we hope that a model will be more suitable for Hong Kong to be rolled out after this consultation exercise. So after these several rounds of consultation with the industry, I understand that only a few insurers may not be able to meet the new requirements immediately. Maybe I'll ask my colleagues from the IA to elaborate on these few insurers and what measures we can introduce to assist them to comply with the regulatory requirements. On the fees for the intermediaries, we understand that we should try to assist the insurers to minimize the impact of starting to charge the fees again after the five-year waiver. We have actually taken into account the arrangements in nearby places like Macau on the licensing arrangements and the fees arrangements. And we find that our arrangement is actually reasonable as compared to these different places. During the consultation, we have heard the views from the industry for certain particular fees. It is set at a three-year period, and we also empower the IA to charge for a lesser fee for a shorter period of time. Mr. Lee has pointed out that we are adopting the cost recovery principle in setting the fees. I will defer to my IA colleagues to respond on that. So first, may I defer to Tony on the LBC regime? Thank you, Mr. Lee, for your questions. As Ms. Zheng has pointed out, after the quantitative assessment exercises, the insurers are aware of the new requirements and they are able to meet them. At the moment, we have about only 2 to 3 insurance companies which would need more time. For example, they may need to amend their investment strategy, and also they would have to look at some of their policies, so they would need more time. During the consultation process, we are aware of the problems that they are facing, and we have a close liaison with them. So now we have a three-year transition period, and we hope that we can assess the risk profile that they are facing. And then 3 years later, they will be able to meet the new requirements under the RBC regime. Any further supplement? Peter, would you like to supplement on the licensing fees?
Yes, so essentially the cost The cost recovery principle works on the basis of the IA's income being sufficient to cover the costs of its operation to perform its functions, but not going beyond this. And prior to charging the intermediary fees, which had been waived for 5 years, we had two principal sources of income: policyholder levies, which are 0.1% on the premiums which insurers charged, and the authorization and approval fees that insurance companies have to pay. Now, with the waiver period coming to an end for the intermediaries fees, we have this third stream of income that we have to consider. And in applying the cost recovery principle, we don't allocate any specific stream of income to a specific type of work that we do. Rather, we aim to ensure that the totality of all our income streams collectively cover the costs of the IA's operation to deliver the functions that we have to perform, which would include all overheads and operating expenses. So we estimate around not more than 10% is actually going to be, of our income is going to come in from the intermediary licensing fees. But in terms of actual regulatory work, we have, if you look at our staff composition, around 30% of our resources are dedicated to intermediary-focused regulation. So again, that shows we can't allocate a specific income stream to specific type of work. But in any event, how we apply that cost recovery principle, that's how we apply it. We look to ensure that the income from all three sources of our income will cover the IA's operation, but not go beyond this. And this is really central to our budgeting and corporate process planning, so that we can in the future reach that break-even stage that we're aiming for.
Okay, thank you.
Mr.
Chen Puilong, thank you, Chair. For the RBC regime, I understand that there has been full consultation with the industry and there is consensus. For the six pieces of subsidiary legislation, it affects the evaluation and reporting. And we understand that the capital market is quite volatile at this stage. So we hope that during this stage, individual insurers will not be affected that much. So with the passing of the subsidiary legislation, I hope the administration will closely monitor the situation to see whether adjustments have to be made. And also, during the implementation stage, would you be exercising some flexibility to cater for insurers who may not be able to meet the capital requirements because of the volatility of the market. On the intermediary fees, I have a question. Now you have fees for 3-year, 2-year, and 1-year licenses. I understand that most of the intermediaries would go for a 3-year license. So during the first year, they paid up a fee for the 3-year period. For example, 24, 25 is the first year that you would collect a freeze, and then by 26, 27, you may have less or very little income from the licensing fees. So for the latter 2 years, how are you going to deal with the situation? Would that affect the operating costs of the IA? Because I understand that the number of intermediary fees should be in thousands of millions. I understand the IA also has the responsibility to enhance the development of the insurance industry. If the licensing fees collected, would you set aside some of them for enhancing the quality or the training of the intermediaries? So you charge a higher fee, but then you would provide a better support. Then I think maybe the intermediaries would feel better for paying a higher fee. Ms. Zhang, thank you. For the RBC regime, I would like to point out that we let the individual insurers have the flexibility. Of course, there is volatility in the capital market, but if the insurers manage the risk well and match the risk profile with the investment better, then in a way there would be a lesser requirement on capital for them. Tony has also pointed out that a few individual insurers may have a capital gap, but we are actually providing them with a 3-year transition period so that gradually they can meet the requirement. So the IA actually has been paying attention to the matter to ensure that all the insurers would understand the system and make best use of the system for them to make use of the capital to match the risks. Starting from the 23rd of September this year, we will start to collect intermediary fees. So it depends on the period of the license. We anticipate that for the first financial year, we'll be able to collect about 10% of the fees, because for the individual license holders, their licenses are still valid, so there is no need for them to renew their license. It is only those companies or individuals who have to renew their license after the 23rd of September have to pay the fees. So we anticipate that we will need several years in order for us to collect $50 million. And for the first year, we anticipate that we may only collect a few million of dollars through the fees. Thirdly, Peter has also explained that when we calculate the cost, we look at the activities of the IA holistically. We look at the expenses, for example, like how to enhance training or regulation of the intermediaries. We also want to promote good practices and codes of practice. So all these work will be included. And maybe I'll allow some time for Peter to elaborate on that. They have actually done a lot of work on this aspect. Mr. Gregor.
Thank you very much. And again, thank you for the question. On the training, yes, this is something that we place a lot of emphasis on. In the past few years, we have rolled out a number of courses on ECPD training for intermediaries on business ethics. Mm. And last year, we rolled out the first anti-money laundering course for intermediaries to help them understand how to comply with the anti-money laundering requirements in their day-to-day practice. We view training very much as a way of helping intermediaries build a career, stay professional, and most of all, stay compliant, because that helps protect policyholders and deliver services, helps them deliver services to policyholders. This is something that we will continue to be doing. We have in our corporate plan, actually, looking to do training for responsible officers of broker companies to assist them in their in their management of their technical representatives. And each year we will continue to provide training, probably face-to-face through the industry bodies, so that we can have that direct interaction with the intermediaries and provide them with practical ways on how to comply with the regulatory requirements and set our expectations in that way.
Okay. Thank you.
Next, Mr. Johnny Ng. Thank you, Chair. In principle, I support the proposed legislative amendments in the RBC regime. I have two questions. Some colleagues have asked about the intermediary fees, and the administration has responded to that, and I understand the situation. I appreciate that the IA has to balance the books and have a healthy development. For the fees to be collected, I would like to know, apart from spending them on training, would you allocate some of them for public education? Because a lot of citizens will think that they want to go and get a policy, insurance policy, but they are not fully aware with the legislative requirements. So would you do any work on this respect about public education and publicity? The second question concerns the insurers about the allocation of capital for investment. The FSTB has been advocating the development of virtual assets, and I would like to know whether the insurers can allocate some of their capital for investment in such products and hope that they will have a balanced development. I understand that now they can invest, but they cannot counter into the solvency margin. But I appreciate that in some other countries, they have started to include that. So I would like to know what is the situation here in Hong Kong. Ms. Zheng, well, I would defer the first question to Peter. And for the second question, I will defer that to Tony.
Okay, yes. So thank you for the question. Let me address the question on public education. This is actually part of our function as the IA. It's written in the ordinance. This is something that we have to deliver, and we are delivering it. I can give some good examples of this. We have recently launched a public education campaign to complement a key enforcement action that we took a couple of months ago to really empower mainland China visitors who are coming to Hong Kong to buy insurance to understand the regulatory regime and to enable them to make informed decisions and so that they only use licensed insurance intermediaries. So that's one of the key public education campaigns that we've launched. And only this weekend, actually, we launched an online risk quiz for 1,800 secondary school students in Hong Kong to really help them learn about lifetime risks and insurance protection. What we're trying to do is to ensure that policyholders understand that actually buying insurance is key to any individual financial plan. And it's important that they are empowered with the right information and the right knowledge to be able to make the best decisions for themselves. So this is something we are doing, and this is something that we will be able to continue to do by balancing the books with our three income streams.
Over to Tony. Just then, Dr. Johnny mentioned virtual assets. Virtual assets are constantly evolving and developing. Now, we have looked at the capital regimes of other jurisdictions. Virtual assets are not counted as tangible assets or as part of the assets for insurers yet. Now, we know there are digital currencies going on that may have a role to play, but then for those intangible assets, things are still tricky. Now, for insurers, insurers hold a very small amount of virtual assets so far, but we will keep an eye on the international development. We will conduct timely reviews to ensure that our systems keep pace with the changing times. Mr. Kwok Wai Kong. One question went unanswered from my first question, and that is about the fiscal health of the IA. When can the IA balance the books? Now, one more comment from me. Early this year, when we were talking about the budget, for 2025, early 2025, the IA expected there would be $426 million or so in reserves. Those are the reserves. So will the government stop any further additional funding for the IA? Deputy Secretary. Now, for the next financial year, the IA will be in the red. We are working with the IA to look at its fiscal position. We want the IA to balance the books as soon as they can. The intermediary fees will not play a huge role, but we need to get that money to help the IA balance the books. So in 2 or 3 years, this means by 2026, 2027, the IA should be able to balance its books. Each year, we come to LegCo to explain to LegCo members, and we also get the FS's approval before we approve the IA's budget. So we will keep an eye on this situation. On the second point, on the IA's reserves, the reserves are not a huge sum. Good for maybe less than a year's operating expenditure. We want the IA to have a certain level of reserves to ensure flexibility in the IA's operation. If, say, the IA balances the books in 2 or 3 years from now, maybe a higher level of reserves will reassure everyone. Now, we have been working with the IA to keep an eye on their financial position. Thank you. Now, About the intermediary fees, I have some questions. The IA has a range of revenue options from agents, brokers, policyholders' levies, license fees. All those are income streams for the IA. We have expectations. Policyholders also have expectations. They pay that levy. When something goes wrong, policyholders expect the IA to do something. Intermediaries also have expectations. They pay a license fee. So are there any kind of safeguard or protection for intermediaries? The IA does not explicitly say they will be protecting the intermediaries. The intermediaries are in a tough position. Business is tough, we all know that. Intermediaries are self-employed workers. And because of that status, when disputes arise, intermediaries are in a bad position. They are on the back feet when they try to negotiate with large insurers. These self-employed workers are not fully protected. Of course, some in the public may think those intermediaries know what they have got themselves into, but the insurance workers' unions have heard about cases where even those workers don't have a contract themselves. So when the union gets a request for help, the union has no way to tell what benefits, what protection that worker is entitled to. So for this kind of situation, has the IA talked to insurers about this? So are there guidelines for insurers to the effect that at least each worker has to have a copy of the contract? And the worker should not be denied a copy of the contract because of all those any excuses. We have had cases where a worker tried to get a contract from the insurer to no avail. This may look like a trivial problem, but then this is about defending workers' rights. So what more can the IA do about that? Who would take the question, please? I thank Mr. Kwok for his question and comment. Under the law, the IA has its functions to serve. Ensuring the healthy development of the insurance sector is a shared goal. Frontline insurance workers are part of this ecosystem. The IA has the responsibility to come up with a solution to ensure healthy, sustainable development of the industry. I know the IA has done a lot. Maybe I will invite Peter to tell us more about this.
Mr. Kwok, for raising this very important issue. It's one we've discussed before, and I think it's one we should continue to discuss. The IA's role is, of course, to protect the interests of the insurance buying public. That's the 4.6 million adult population in Hong Kong and the numerous customers who come from other jurisdictions to buy insurance here. We're tasked to do this by regulating the insurance market for the protection of policyholders and so that the market develops in a sustainable and stable manner. But this is the point that I really want to emphasize. The interests of policyholders and the interests of licensed insurance intermediaries who play by the rules are not mutually exclusive. They are aligned. Part of our role as a regulator is to see that those interests do not become misaligned, because where they do become misaligned, that's where you do get, that's where conduct problems arise. So in performing our core policyholder protection role, we are indeed upholding the interests of the hard-working licensed insurance intermediaries who played by the rules. And if I may spend some time giving you some examples of the work that we do in this respect. Firstly, number one, the requirement for intermediaries to be licensed by the IA to sell and give advice on insurance to the public is a key policyholder protection measure because it ensures that only persons who are fit and proper and who have the right qualifications are licensed to give that advice. And our job is to uphold the integrity of that licensing system by taking enforcement action against unlicensed selling where we see it, because unlicensed selling actually puts policyholders at risk. And we saw this in what we were doing in the joint action we took earlier this month with the ICAC against unlicensed selling of insurance. These types of significant enforcement action protect the public from the risk of unlicensed selling, but they also protect the licensed insurance intermediaries who play by the rules and maintain their license, because it ensures that business is not going to be diverted into unlicensed business channels. That's why the operation we took last week was welcomed by a number of bodies in the insurance industry. This wasn't something that the self-regulatory bodies could do. It's something that the IA can do, however, because it is empowered to do so. I think the second thing I'd like to talk about here is, unlike the self-regulatory bodies, we have the power to go in and inspect insurers and look at the way in which they manage their agency forces, because this is important for policyholder protection. That means we can turn up to an insurer's offices and inspect its operation, ask questions about its controls and the support it is giving to the licensed insurance intermediaries who are selling its policies. That's what the whole regulation of the intermediary management function of insurers is there for. Now, we don't interfere with commercial strategies, but we do need to see that an insurer is creating an alignment of interest between its policyholders and the intermediaries who serve them. We don't want, for example, to see a misalignment through overly aggressive sales by the imposition of very high sales targets for intermediaries, for example. So this is a way in which we look to protect policyholders and by doing so align the interests with the intermediaries. We look at persistency rates for policyholders. We look at how insurers are ensuring there's ongoing servicing of the intermediaries for policyholders and how they're developing the careers of their intermediaries through training. When we're doing this, I mean, I've done this myself in going to an insurer, we interview all levels of the agency hierarchy. We discuss with district directors directly to ensure that they are supporting their downline agents to deliver service to policyholders. And yes, we have set standards for onboarding of new agents in terms of training, in terms of contracts, agency contracts, which they have to have, and they should be taking the agent through the terms of the contract so that they know what their requirements are. So there is an alignment between what we do in protecting policyholders and the interests of insurance intermediaries who play by the rules and want to build a healthy career in the insurance industry. I hope that assists in answering your question.
One comment from me, perhaps. My electorate consists of insurers, but I've also received complaints from insurance agents. There are long-standing problems. Now, some insurers do better than the others, but you don't have a standard contract. So when things go wrong, we don't have good protection for some agents. Now, one example that always comes up is that the contract says 3 years. But then on the last day of the second year, one side cancels the contract and the other side wants compensation for all those years. The insurance may want more time for this agent to prove themselves. Now, just then, the IA has made it clear we want to protect policyholders and also intermediaries. We want the intermediaries to know the expectations. But then, as Mr. Kwok said, there's an asymmetry in the relationship. The insurers are in a much stronger financial position. They can go to the court, but life is harder for the intermediaries. So how do we have a fair contract? This is a perennial issue. So maybe the IA can come up with some basic requirements, some essential terms, for example. Just then, Mr. Kwok mentioned some examples where the insurers refused to even provide a copy of the contract to the intermediaries. So maybe the IA can think about what they can do. Better protection for intermediaries means more people will be interested to join the industry. Intermediaries are self-employed workers. They stand on their own feet. So they worry they don't get labor protection. So how do we encourage more competent people to join the sector if we can offer better protection that would be necessary for us to as an international financial center? And now I'll give the floor to Mr. Benson Look.
Thank you, Chairman. For the RBC regime and the intermediary fees legislative amendments, I support them. I understand that for the insurance industry, they are general in support of the proposed legislative amendments. And I think the credit goes to the government for liaising closely with the industry and consulting them. And Chairman, you have also played a part in that. There is one question from me. That is about the appointment of actuaries. I noticed that for the amendment regulation, as stated in the paper, so insurers who are running general business would have to appoint actuaries. And it has to be approved by the IA, as in the insurers conducting long-term business. So I think the question is whether there are sufficient actuaries in the market for appointment. I understand that the government has exercised some flexibility, so the actuary can be self and can be an employee, or the service can be outsourced, say, like a consultant. So for the provision of actuaries, I think the insurers have to look for them from the market. We also have training for actuaries in the universities. But I would like to ask the administration, when you liaise with the industry, are you aware that there is sufficient supply of actuaries for appointment by the insurers? The second question is the same paragraph of the paper. It is stated that on individual case-by-case basis, the IA can exempt the appointment of an actuary. Can you quote some examples? When are you going to waive the requirement? What circumstances will be qualified for that? Mr. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Look. I think your understanding is correct. We have imposed a new requirement for the insurers running general business to appoint actuaries, but they do not have to be employed by the insurer. They can also go for outsourced service. We understand that for some of the insurers, they already have appointed professional actuaries. For the proposed amendment regulation, we have looked at the availability of actuaries in the market, and we also look at the qualifications of the actuaries. And we would recognize these qualifications so as to ensure that there will be sufficient supply of actuaries in the market. For the exemption, we have several considerations. Well, it depends on the business size and the operation. For example, the marine insurers and also the very small size insurers. That means the insurance policies that they have at hand is less than $20 million. The gross premium is less than $20 million. Chairman, you don't have a question? Mr. Kwok, your turn. Well, I support agree with what Peter said. I think the interests of the policyholders and the intermediaries are actually aligned. They are not in contradiction. But I think that may be half correct. I think we want to emphasize that the intermediaries is actually a bridge between the policyholders and the insurance companies. So they represent the company on the one hand, and they also represent the policyholders on the other hand. So for people who have get insurance policies, when you make the claims, you go to the intermediaries for service, for support. It is very seldom that the policyholder will do the claims himself or herself. So in other words, the policyholder will not go to the insurance companies for claims. For the day-to-day operations, for example, if the policyholders do not understand about the documents or the annual reports, then the intermediaries will come in and explain to them. So in a way, the intermediaries actually represent the interests of the policyholders. I hope the IA would look into this and strengthen your work in this aspect. Chairman, we talk about the lack of contracts. It is not a big matter, but it needs to be addressed. But there are actually more important issues and greater issues. Well, I think we all understand, or maybe the citizens who are listening to our meeting may not understand the whole situation. The intermediaries mostly are not employed by a particular company. And very often, they may be hiring people to help them. So the case of not being able to obtain a contract is not that unusual. So that's why we have to take a top-down approach. We understand that there have been disputes about certain contracts. And then the parties concerned actually go to the IA for assistance because they think that the IA should protect them as well. But I was told that the staff of IA, I don't know who he or she is, but the staff tell the person concerned to go to the union for the insurance companies and come to us. We are actually willing to help them. But we want to point out that even though we have the network, we are able to collect some of the information or tender advice, but we are not a statutory body. And the insurance company will not always collaborate with us. So I hope the IA, on a need basis, would try to assist us to help us to handle these cases, for example, to gather the relevant information so that we can take follow-up action. And please don't just refer the cases to us. I don't know whether you can take this question or not. Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Mr. Kwok, for bringing the situation to us. I think as a regulatory body, it is not always possible for it to deal with each and every dispute. Nonetheless, on the whole, we try to regulate the industry as a whole, and we are able to help the intermediaries. As the chairman has pointed out, we can enhance the relationship with the companies and help them to enhance their bargaining power and negotiate with the companies, and also to enhance their own capability. I think the IA can help with that, and maybe IA can elaborate on that. Peter?
Yes, Mr. Kwok, I think your description of intermediaries is absolutely correct. They are there to represent the policyholders. Brokers, of course, they have to do that as a matter of law. Agents as well, although they are appointed by the company, do have duties to assist the policyholder. So they are representing the policyholder, and you're absolutely right, they do go. It is the habit of a policyholder to deal with the person representing the company who they know the most, which is usually the agent. So in submitting claims and things like that, they will go through the intermediary. And it's precisely for this reason that we look for that alignment of interests. We need to see insurers supporting the intermediaries so that intermediaries can deliver their services to the policyholders. And that's the lens through which we look at things. That's how we regulate the market. And if insurers are not doing that, then yes, in terms of bargaining position, they don't need to worry. We will step in and use our powers against the insurers to right that wrong. We will hold insurers to account for that. Now, that's not to say that we are the equivalent of the Labour Department for intermediaries. We still have to always look at things through that lens of being a regulator. And so I noted the examples you gave. Rather than discussing specific examples, which I'm not actually aware of, I would say that our job is to ensure that insurers are providing those controls and support for their intermediaries so intermediaries can deliver the services and represent the policyholders correctly. And to the extent they're not doing that, we will hold insurers to account for that.
Chairman, thank you. And thank you, Peter, for your response. Well, there may be some odd cases, and I appreciate that IA had its own operation procedures. I would just like to point out that if the cases refer to the Hong Kong IPGU and want us to follow up, I hope the IA could assist us in dealing with these cases because some of them are actually quite difficult. Lastly, Chairman, I would like to seek a clarification. Some 10 years have passed, and back in 2013 in Zurich, for the Zurich company, they have sacked a number of representatives, some 700 of them. Well, why do I talk about this old case? Because at that time, I was working with the affected intermediaries, and we tried to follow up with the relevant regulatory body then. And that body was very helpful. They have been liaising with us and the insurance company and try to, by the end of the day, reach a consensus. Why do I bring out this case? Because I just want to make a comparison. If today there is a big insurer and make the commercial decision maybe to sell the company or try to sack a large number of staff, then what would the insurance authority do? Would it be also intervening to ensure that the staff concerns' rights will be protected? Will you try to help the intermediaries and protect their interests? I just want to clarify this point. Who would take this question? Peter?
Thank you, Mr. Kwok. I recall that Zurich matter. I was in the industry myself at that time. It was a long time ago, but I do recall it. I think if a similar incident were to happen today, again, we, the IA, would use our powers to look at, to intervene to the extent that the interests of policyholders demand it. So, for example, if you did have a case where an insurer is looking to change its business model by exiting a specific distribution channel and, you know, move from a tied agency force model to some other type of model, we would intervene to ensure that when it's doing this, it acts fairly to policyholders who are going to be affected by this. And that, what we'd want to see is we would want to see that they are ensuring continuity of particularly the servicing obligations for the policies that they've written. We don't want to see any of those policies becoming orphaned so that there's no services. So now it would be, we wouldn't limit the insurer as to how it would achieve this, but probably the most likely way it would need to achieve this would be rather than having a one of the ways would be rather than having a one-off straightforward cut of all the tied agents, it would have to have a more managed managed transition to that new business model, so that the agents continue to be there to support the policyholders who the insurer has made policy commitments to. So again, I emphasize we view these things through the policyholder lens, but you see there is an alignment with the interests of intermediaries are there. So I hope that assists in answering your question. If this, I mean, the likelihood is this would be something that we would hear about before the union heard about it. I think we have, for example, we have the chairperson of the union is on our expert panel. So we do get intelligence that way. We have a number of people from the industry on our expert panel. It gives us intelligence from what's happening in the industry. And that enables us to react, well, not react, be proactive in dealing with these situations.
Well, I want to jump in too. I got involved too. People also came to me back then. So I talked to both sides. Peter was saying something about continuity. The insurer had to ensure continuity of service. So what are some ways we have to ensure continued service? Those are the things we will look at. We managed to fix it back then. We will be able to fix it in the future. Of course, an insurer has its own reasons to solve its business. Agents were involved, the headquarters of an insurer were involved, we managed to fix it. So above all, what matters is that we all work together to fix the problem. Other questions from Mr. Kwok? No, thank you. Now we are done with the policy discussions. We can get into the clauses. But first, it's a question, do we want to invite public submissions on the 14 pieces of subsidiary legislation? As I said, Mr. Chen Puleng and I are in the insurance sector. We checked with insurers. Insurers have no objection. As for agents and brokers, we also worked through Mr. Kwok Wai Kung. We set up meetings. The government met with brokers and agents. So let's invite written submissions for anyone who wish to make their views known. Now we're done with the policy discussions. So now let's get into the clauses. Now we come to the one about intermediary fees. The legal service division prepared the marked up copies. CB bracket 1628 stroke 2024 numbers 1 to 7. So here's my suggestion. Let's invite the government to walk us through the clauses. We start with the Chinese text. If the legal advisor comes across anything out of the ordinary, feel free to let the subcommittee know. So I now invite the government to walk us through the clauses. I invite my colleague, Mr. Ngan, Mr. Andrew Ngan. So now we are at Insurance Prescribed Fees Amendment Regulation 2024. Now, this one has to do with the fees payable to the IA. Are you on 01? Let's stick to the marked up copy, number 01. Please also quote the page number so that we will have an easier time following where you are. So let's start with 0001. Now, there are two kinds of fees. One, those for the new RBC regime, and second, for intermediaries applying for a license. Now, the first one is outside the marked up copy. The first one is about the commencement date. Now, the RBC regime will take effect on the 1st of July this year. As for the provisions on the intermediary fees, will take effect on the 23rd of September this year instead. The second rule is also beyond the marked up copy that has to do with the scope of this amendment. We're now at Rule 3, Regulation 3, minor changes to the text. This is about submission of information to the IA. Clause 4, or rather Regulation 4, when appropriate, the IA can exempt fees in full or in part for intermediaries or return fees paid in part or in full. This gives the IA flexibility to deal with special circumstances. One example, say you have an agent, they want to become a broker instead. Within the 3 months of the revocation of the old license, this person can apply for the new license. This person can get a reduction in the license fee. In that case, this person won't have to pay the fees twice. Now, 5, 1, and 2. We are on page 2. For new provisions, we are making changes to the numbering. 5, bracket 3, also on page 2, we are introducing interpretation. And this has to do with license and linked long-term business. Now we come to the fees. Now, there are lots of details, so I will go by the number. Part 1, fees payable. Item 6. Now, there are fees for minority shareholders and majority shareholder controllers. Under the existing insurance ordinance, there were shareholder controllers. Those holding 15% or more of the shares, they have to apply to the IA before becoming a shareholder controller. In the ordinance, amendment ordinance, we break that down into minority and majority controllers. Minority 3 to 15%, majority 15% and above. So we have to distinguish that also under this cap 41B. Now, for general business, insurers also have to appoint actuaries. And now there are also fees applicable. 7BA, 7BZ, from pages 4 to 28. All these items have to do with the intermediary's license fees. 7BA, that's on page 4. Now, for an insurer that wishes to appoint an agent, they have to report the matter to the IA. So there is this notification fee, 7BB to 7BJ, pages 7 to 12, 7BB, 7BC, 7BD. Pages 4, 5, and 6. These three items have to do with insurance agencies making changes to their lines of business. They may want to switch from one line of business to the another, so they have to file an application. 7BB, addition of general or long-term business, but not linked business. 7BC, on top of long-term business, someone wants to add linked long-term business that applies, and 7BD, general business, and you add linked long-term business. Now, there is flexibility for the three items. For this agency, the shorter the remaining period of the existing license, the less fees they pay. 7BE, 7BF, 7BG. Pages 7 through 9. Just like what we saw before, this has to do with the representatives and also different kinds of representatives, when they represent different kinds of businesses, they pay different fees. Page 10, 7BH, 7BI, 7BJ, those are on pages 10 to 12. Those three fees have to do with the agents' companies. When they want to add different lines of businesses, they have to pay different fees. Different kinds of intermediaries can also pay the relevant fees based on the time left on their existing licenses. Now on page 12, 7BK, from 7BK through 7BU, fees for new licenses for intermediaries. We're now at 7BK. So when an insurance agency, they apply for a license, you have to pay those fees, 7BL, 7BM, 7BN, pages 13 through 15. These are for individual insurance agents. They apply for 3-year, 2-year, 1-year licenses. They have to pay certain fees. For natural persons, they can choose from those different license periods. That flexibility is added based on the feedback from previous consultations. Now we're on page 15, 7BO, page 16, 7BP, page 17, 7BQ. Those three fees apply to 3-year, 2-year, and 1-year licenses. Page 18, 7BR. Insurance broker company applying for a license, they pay those fees, 7BS, 7BT, 7BU, pages 19 and 20. Those have to do with the fees for insurance broker companies applying for different kinds of businesses. Page 21 and page 22, 7BV, 7BW. Now for recognized or licensed insurance broker companies, these fees have to do with the applications involving responsible officers. Page 22, 7BX through 7BZE, all the way to page 28. These fees have to do with renewal. Those are fees payable upon renewal. Page 22, 7BX. Renewal fees for a licensed insurance agency. So the fewer technical representatives, the lower the fees. Pages 23 and 24, 7BY, 7BZ. Renewal for 2 years and 3 years, different fees applied. Pages 24 and 25, 7BZA, 7BZB. Renewal for 3 years and 2 years, different fees apply. Page 26, 7BZC. This applies to renewal involving licensed insurance broker companies. Again, we look at the number of technical representatives. The fewer representatives, the lower the fees. Pages 27, 28, 7BZD and 7BZE. Renewal for 3 years and 2 years for any licensed insurance broker company. Page 28, 7BZF. When someone talks to the IA and asks for an exemption from the provisions of Part X of the ordinance, that fee applies. Page 29, 7C, 7D, and 7E, I will go through them in one go. We had the amendment to the insurance ordinance. We distinguish between minority and majority shareholder controllers. Now for designated insurance holding companies, we amend those fees. This has to do with the distinction between minority and majority shareholder controllers. Now for designated insurance holding companies or DIHCs, under the current scheme, the IA looks at the impact of that holding company and then proceeds to regulate the insurer based on the influence of those DIHCs. Page 32. Item number 8 in the table. Now, when the majority shareholding controller becomes a minority shareholder company, that person or that party has to let the IA know. Page 33. Item 9, we are repealing the fees about notification, though we're keeping the part about appointing an auditor. Now, we have dealt with the actuary with Section 5, Bracket 5.
Now we come to page 34. It is because we have repealed Schedule 3 of the current regulation, so that's why we have to put in new requirements about the submission of statements and other information. So these are just textual amendments. For 16A, we're still on page 34, Section 16A. It's about the submission of information to the authority in relation to the requirements for disclosure of information. On page 35, Section 17 and Section 18A will be introduced together. For the amendment legislation, it is stated that according to Section 22A or 25AA, they can submit the information authority to the IA for the permit to a non-Hong Kong insurer to comply with this section. Now we move on to page 36, Section 20A. Similarly, this is because of the proposed amendments. We stated that for Lloyds, it can requests to the authority for waiving the requirements under Section 50C, Bracket 10, for the submission of an annual report and the fees payable. We propose this amendment so that the fees for Lloyds will be the same as other insurers. I have a question. On Section 20A, you have a fee for $300,000. What is that fee for? You talk about Section 128, Bracket 1, so they can apply to the authority for approval of a transfer under Section 25D, Bracket 1 of the ordinance. What is this fee provided for? This is actually an existing fee under the existing provision. Is it too high? You are charging $300,000. What is this fee for? This is the existing fee, right? Yes, this is for the transfer. So under what circumstances will you charge this? So that means you're transferring from insurer A to insurer B. You have to be approved by the IA and assessed by the IA. Sorry, I didn't get it. That means the businesses are transferred from insurer A to insurer B. Oh yes, this is a major matter. So that's why you charge such a high fee. Okay, please continue. So if you have questions, please do raise them. We are still on page 36. We're now on Section 21A. As I stated before, because of the introduction of minority and majority shareholder controller, so if a person has become a minority shareholder controller, then you have to notify the IA, and this is the fee charge. Page 37, Section 24, there is a new requirement about the submission of statements and reports and information to the IA. Because of this new requirement, we stipulate that if they want to extend the period for submitting such information, then they have to pay the fee to the IA. So this new fee will replace the fee that we have on Section 15. Now we move on to Part 2, that is the fees payable under insurance valuation and capital rules. So this is also a new rules from the IA. It is quite lengthy. It is saying that the insurers will have to comply with the capital requirements. So there are six fees concerned. So that means if they do not want to use the standard formulation to calculate the capital amount, then they have to apply to the IA and submit the fees. Generally, the insurers would like to lower their capital requirements, and we want to provide flexibility for that. Now we are on page 38, item 1, that is, when they want to classify some investment as strategic investment, then they can also reduce their capital investment amount, and again, it has to be approved by the IA. Still on page 38, item 2. Item 2 is that if an insurer, when they try to set up their capital amount, if they want to take into account reinsurance and the reduction of that, then they again have to submit the case to the IA, and this is the fee for such application. Page 39, item 3. The fee concerns the case if the insurer would like to use their own risk capital amount for natural catastrophe risk, then they have to apply for approval from the IA and they have to provide a fee. And if the approval is approved, then they have to submit information regularly to the IA for continuous monitoring. So if the insurer has to provide the information, then we will talk about the fee of item 4, and the fee in item 4 will be applicable if submission of information to IA is needed. Item 5 and item 6 on page 39 and 40. Item 5 is saying that an insurer would like to use internal assessment process to map exposure to an instrument or a party to the appropriate credit rating band. Then again, they have to apply to the IA for approval, and the fee is stipulated in item 5. Well, similar to what I have just said, if the case is approved by the IA, then the IA will require the insurer to supply information regularly for continuous monitoring, and the submission of information would incur a fee, and that is stated in item 6. That's all for my introduction. So I would like to ask the legal advisor, do you have any questions from the drafting point of view? Chairman, I don't have any drafting or legal questions, and I think both the English and the Chinese version are in order. Thank you. So do members agree that on the 5th of June I will move a motion to defer the scrutiny period to the 26th of June because we have to submit report to the House Committee. I think that is the earliest date that we can do so. Any further comments? If not, then I think we have completed the work for today. Well, these are very technical amendments, but I think the proposed amendments are in general supported by the industry. So I think the clause-by-clause scrutiny has been quite simple today. Well, thank you very much for taking time to attend the meeting. Any other business from members? If not, we'll close the meeting. Thank you for coming. Also, thank you, the administration, for attending the meeting.